The topics we discuss are many.
No story too bold to talk about.
Strictly our own opinions.
But they are opinions from people like you.
Welcome to the Naked Podcast.
Hey, everybody. It's your favorite, not the imposter, Ethan.
You were the chosen one, Ethan. You said you would bring balance to the Force, not leave it in darkness. It's your DM Tekka Allen.
I did bring balance to the Force.
Did you, though?
Well, that seems pretty balanced to me. It's NJ.
Okay, hold on. We can't leave that unsettled. Anakin did bring balance to the Force. No one can deny this.
Yeah.
There were way more Jedi than Sith. So at the end of Order 66, technically in the original movies, there were two Jedi and two Sith. Balanced. All right. Move on with the podcast.
On that note, let's talk about Biden's first 2 weeks in
office. They were like Darth Sidious's first 2 weeks in office.
I was going to say, you mean Emperor Biden?
He's not an emperor.
Can Kamala Harris please say, I am the Senate? please.
I don't want her to say that. I don't want anyone to say that.
Yeah, I don't want anybody to say that either. So Biden has a busy snicker, and we start with story. Look, I'm literally wearing a Star Wars shirt today just for this podcast.
I wore this shirt especially for Snicker Bass.
Okay, we're getting distracted. So Biden has had a busy first two weeks. He has signed in a lot of different executive orders, way more than any other previously sitting president within the last couple administrations. So what executive orders has he signed?
I believe I looked at 28 officials have been signed and gone in. The first and biggest one was the Keystone pipeline cancellation. Plus the halting of the border wall, the talks to rejoin the Paris Accords, and talks to rejoin the Iranian nuclear deals. Those are some of the ones that the more important ones, I would think, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Like the immigration ones, I wasn't exactly happy about. I think the strides we made in the last year, at least, on how we handle, you know, the immigration and the people that are coming here, how they're being treated, was a little better in the last year than it's going to be this year. I because, you know, my day job, I saw the construction of the original soft-sided temporary structures. And then I saw them being torn down. And I didn't make any money at that point. And now I'm watching them be rebuilt. So I don't know. From experience, I think we were better off before his executive order to rebuild them. But hey.
I'm not too familiar with like what exactly is going on and with the immigration. I feel like I've been more focused on COVID relief bill than anything else. So, you know, like Biden has argued that the economy does need a boost. And, you know, he's trying to pass that $1.9 trillion relief package. But there are still some details to hammer out. So Biden says likely they're going to have to drop the $15 minimum wage. And he doesn't want to do that. But Ethan, you could probably give a little bit more context here. He had said that they had passed something called budget reconciliation, and the rules of that supposedly won't allow them to include the $15 minimum wage. So what is that? Like, I couldn't really find much.
Yeah. So what's stopping the $15 minimum wage is actually, so when the Senate has already passed, right? They've approved of this package, which as for somebody who wanted unity, they said, we're going to pass it anyway. And they did push it through. All 50 Republicans did say no. And all 50 Democrats said yes. And then Kamala Harris said, we're going to push it through. I vote yes. So, so one of the riders that the Republicans were able to get in, which was the budget reconciliation, was just a fancy term for we got to trim some fat out of the budget. So let's not raise the $15 minimum wage yet, because it would have taken effect in governmental jobs before anything else, which would have raised the budget for the government.
Okay.
Well, you know, I think there, you know, we've talked about it before, where certain bills that get presented to Congress have a lot of hidden things to it. Mm-hmm. And I do agree with you in the sense that, you know, Biden did talk a lot about unity and bipartisanship. And that was, you know, one of the things that I was really looking forward to with his administration. So while, you know, I do agree that relief needs to be, you know, given with this package, you know, it's going to add funding towards vaccinations, which is like an important thing right now, especially with that new virus mutation in Africa. Like, we have to get ahead of that, before it comes here, if it travels. Mm-hmm. Peach's hair is floating in the wind.
It is.
one of the reasons to pay attention to the immigration policies is because he did make some campaign promises, mm-hmm. that migrants are taking serious, so that if you come here, you'll get vaccinated, you'll get the health care, mm-hmm. you'll get included on the stimulus package, you'll get a stimulus check. You know, there's some things that they were led to believe, so they are coming here, quoting Biden himself, which some of the videos that have been posted by people down in Mexico and other things are them quoting and saying Biden promised to take care of us and like all these other items. So that's one of the biggest reasons to watch what's happening, at least with the caravan, because they're coming here because we kind of promised them some stuff. You know, our president leads our country. So our country promised some stuff. And what are we going to do to fulfill that? Now, the question is, how can we give vaccines to people coming here when we can't even give vaccines to the people that need them right now? And I'm hesitant to okay more money going to vaccine distribution when vaccines are already starting to be mishandled, disappearing. I think
fucking being destroyed. I heard
about a thing about 40 million vaccines are unaccounted for currently. So
what?
I don't know how true that is, but that there was an article saying that there is a 40 million currently unaccounted for. Now, that doesn't mean they've been messed up or, you know, they're lost or whatever. They just don't know where they are at currently.
I listened to something pretty interesting earlier where they were saying that people are vaccine shopping, which is like they're putting themselves on several different lists to try to jump ahead of the line or you know, to mm-hmm. get one, whether it's in the same city, the next county over, or even the next state over. And they're talking about like how unethical that is, you know, for you to do if you're not in a priority group, number one, and number two, like you're basically taking it away from your neighbor. And if we're struggling in that aspect, we're going to be struggling a lot more.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so from what I believe, there's four currently available, four different vaccines from the big four players. And there's one more that's coming out that's supposed to be a more traditional vaccine that they're working on. They think that's going to take about another year to get finalized with testing. But, mm-hmm. you know, personally, I would wait till the more traditional vaccine myself. Mm-hmm. Before I take one, I'm not very comfortable with these rushed ones. So I don't know how to feel about the vaccines or anything. And I feel like the more it's getting pushed upon me, the more I will resist it.
It's in your nature.
Yeah.
One of us.
Yeah. Well, I know like a couple weeks ago, we were talking about the vaccine and how some scientists were saying, well, maybe we just vaccinate a large amount of people. And then by the time that their second dose comes around, then we'll have more of the vaccine. But Dr. Fauci actually said that there's just not enough data to support that idea. Mm-hmm. And we just don't have the doses, nor can we guarantee it, especially when we don't have a relief package that's you know, not 100% certain. And, you know, over a million doses are going to retail pharmacies this week alone, like CVS, Walgreens, Walmart, et cetera. But, you know, again, these people are vaccine shopping and jumping ahead of the line. So first we had our essential workers, our frontline workers. Then it's like teachers, and then it's, you know, whoever else after that. So like for me, I work from home. Like I don't need the vaccine, so I'm totally fine waiting. Plus, yeah, you know, I have a little bit of a trust issue too with it, because it was just so fast.
Well,
yeah.
I kind of want to quickly cover a story that I think you talked about, or that we found out together. There was this rich couple that decided to go from the States all the way to some place over in Canada, a really small town, to get their vaccine. And they took first class over there, came back, then went back for the second dose. By that time, the Canadian government had already realized that they weren't residents of the town, so they fined them $125,000. Sorry, $1,250 or something along those lines.
I mean, if you have the money to not worry about flying first class there and back, I don't think $1,200. They probably were just like, whatever, I got my vaccine, I'm happy.
You know,
like,
what?
I'm safe.
You know what? I lied. It wasn't first class. They flew their own plane there. I forgot how rich these people were.
They definitely weren't worried about that.
Yeah.
That fine.
And then there's new reports coming out that the vaccine that was being distributed in Africa actually isn't as effective against their vaccine.
Foundation vaccine?
I believe so. It wasn't the Moderna or the Pfizer one.
Whatever you do, never take anything that the Gates Foundation tries to give you.
No, like, no, it wasn't the Gates Foundation.
It's AstraZeneca is the brand of that vaccine.
I'm not sure. I think the more traditional vaccine is supposed to be Johnson & Johnson, I think.
Yeah, Johnson & Johnson, responsible for getting people hooked on opioids.
Yeah, pretty much.
Oh, wait, no. It wasn't just them. It was another company.
Another pharmaceutical.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but...
big fucking family.
So, these first 2 weeks were interesting to watch. You know, so Joe Biden did campaign on... he wanted to be a unifying candidate, but he does feel like... or it does look like he's attacking a lot of his, you know, his predecessor... and the people that supported him, mm-hmm, on some of the actions. They're just to undo, like, there's more important things going on right now than, mm-hmm, some of these, right?
Yeah.
And personally, like, I didn't agree with the, like, so the, what was it, the 1776 commission that they put in place, I thought was okay. I didn't think it was a bad thing. What it was replacing, I viewed as kind of a racist promotional tool. Like, I don't know. It doesn't make sense to, you know, classify people by race and say you're not being racist. That just kind of doesn't make sense to me. So.
I got you.
But so some of the things he's doing, it feels like canceling the pipeline. Like, I didn't see where that was necessary or unifying in any way, because Republicans have fought hard to get that pipeline. Mm-hmm. I mean, it took years, even with, you know, Republican president plus, you know, control of the House and Senate at the time.
Over 10 years for sure.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't see how canceling it was unifying, especially putting workers out of place automatically, or their stance towards the workers, I have not agreed with anyway. They'll just find another job is not a loving statement.
Yeah, it's not a good enough answer. But I mean, Biden has been pushing this pro-green initiative even when he was with Obama. So it makes sense for him to cancel it. But I agree with you. The way they handled whole worker situation was not great.
Yeah, but their version of green doesn't always make sense. You know, like, mm-hmm, their climate czar flies around in his own private jet. Like, he can't use commercial airlines. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
It's just there's too much hypocrisy behind and then pushing the Green New Deal and other items. The Green New Deal is a horrible piece of legislation. Like, yeah, we need to do better. You know, I'm a very energy conscious person myself. Mm-hmm. I do everything. I mean, I got solar panels on my truck, you know, so I do everything I can. And I can tell you what they're planning and what they suggest on doing is not beneficial. I mean, windmills are not a very good long term form of energy. We know this. We've done a lot better with hydro energy. So like Hoover Dam or tidal current energy. That's very well. Geothermal. We do have that. And of course, you know, thorium nuclear energy is the way of the future, man. Come on.
Yeah, Raisin, it was the pipeline was one that some natives were fighting against, but some others had taken the deal from the government to sell that part of land or use that part of land. So with the pipeline being canceled, those funds to those tribes were not delivered. From an environmental standard, like I can understand why the Keystone pipeline was canceled. I mean, just the type of oil that it is with tar sands, it's a lot more likely to leak, you know, and especially traveling literally like halving the country. It's a lot. But yeah. At the same time, like, you know, I don't know what kind of technology there is, and green energy isn't all that green. You know, windmills, there's so many farms of like windmill parts that are just debris and taking up space. So yeah, I don't know what the answer is.
I don't either.
Nuclear, that's really moving forward. I mean, so people are scared of it because we've had two bad incidents, right? I mean,
incidents, Chernobyl and what happened, was it Japan?
Japan. Fukushima, I believe it is. Mm-hmm. I might have said that wrong, but I mean, yeah, they're bad, but at the same time, I mean, we've done a lot worse to the environment. I mean, BP oil spill, let's just say that, right? So
yeah,
then, and the issue with those two that did blow up was they were using plutonium to power them. Well, we've found other ways to power the nuclear reactors with other elements that are very close to plutonium that are a little safer. So I mean, there's options out there, but at the same time, how are we going to know that it's a bad idea unless we even, you know, fund some research to look into it? If you really want to say you're bettering the planet and you want to move towards cleaner energy, shouldn't you at least examine all options, not just the two you think are good?
Yeah.
Yeah, I can agree with that. I think like, I feel like as I've gotten older, I've learned that things are not as linear as I thought they were. You know, a lot of things are either hypotheses or things that are like, we're pretty sure it's this way. But I think the essence of humanity is that we have to consider that, of course, things change, but that means our thinking should change too. So I would agree that more research is needed. Personally, even the mention of nuclear power freaks me the fuck out. But I think that's just really how we were conditioned to think about nuclear times, especially when baby boomers raised Gen X, raised us, and they went through that time of nuclear drills. You know, like it was like a fear. So that still is kind of in our generations.
Yeah, I get that. For me, Raisin, honestly, from my experience, solar is not the most cost-effective, but it is the most long-term, that we have the best chance with long-term, because you have solar shingles you can put on your house. They even develop like solar driveways. You could have pretty much all the concrete and, you know, tile of your house on the outside replaced with solar panels in a way where you're not really harming the natural environment and you're still able to harness power. Like windmills are horrible for, you know, wildlife. When you build a windmill, it's there forever. And you need a couple acres of land to function properly for one windmill, mm-hmm. let alone all the windmills we would need. So yeah, OG Beards, yeah, the Tesla roof shingles. Yeah, Elon Musk actually had him put on his house for the test. So
nice.
He's doing the life cycle test on his house. It's funny.
So let's move on a little past this. I know that we've gotten a little off topic, but
yeah, yeah,
we can talk about clean energy all day.
Yeah,
yeah,
all day.
All day. Well, I mean, as an electrician, I would expect for you to be able to talk about electricity and different sort of currents and forms of energy all day.
The world operates on a sine wave, everybody.
Oh my God.
Moving on. I don't have tinfoil hat time on our list, but I'll add it for the next episode.
Wait, well, speaking of tinfoil hats,
no.
You know, a lot of like, you know, with news of the election that has come out over the last couple of months, there was always kind of like a polarization between what the media was reporting, actualization, and then I guess the lie. So Times had actually come out with an article recently, and they had some interesting revelations, but the terminology and language used in the article was a little bit scary. So what was that about?
So to add some context to it, right? You had one person saying, hey, something's wrong. You had 50 to 100 people come up, say, signed affidavits. Hey, we felt like there was some errors that happened, and nobody refuses to look at them, right?
Mm-hmm.
You had one person banned off every social media on the face of the earth over all of this.
Mm-hmm.
You had a guy sworn in behind 30,000 armed troops behind a razor wire fence, and then an article drops talking about how an election was fortified for the right event to have or right outcome to happen. And I don't have the article pulled up. I would like to read the article verbatim if anyone has it pulled up.
I have it right here. Yeah.
You don't have to read the whole article, but in the article, it does state a shadowy cabal helped or came together between industry and workers of the world and fortified the election. It was the biggest thing that bothered me was that it says we were able to raise an army of poll workers. Well, from my understanding, all poll workers are supposed to be volunteers only, and they're supposed to be half and half of registered Democrats, registered Republicans. So
the actual terminology on that one, because after we talked about it last night, I read the article in full, and it says they recruited poll workers, not hired.
Okay.
Yeah.
But even then, a shadowy cabal recruited.
So here's what happened. So there is this man. Hold on. Let me grab his name so I don't butcher it.
You're talking about the Times article author?
So. Time magazine put out an article, and I believe New York Times also put out an article yesterday.
Okay. So his name is Mike Podhoser. In 2019, he had this like inkling that the election was like headed for a disaster. And there's a couple different outcomes that he saw. Trump would lose and he wouldn't concede. There was like several other, I guess, scenarios that could happen. Mm-hmm. And basically what he did is that they started doing research. He opened up like this network for people who don't really communicate. And how the article kind of opened was more so seeing these big businesses turned on President Trump, and kind of partnered with the left, so to speak, to organize other things. So like in Michigan, for example, they started the hashtag all eyes on MI, like mm-hmm. all eyes on me, and this kind of organizing the effort, you know, to get people out to the polls or maybe like put certain out information about mail-in ballots, etc. And then, you know, with the civil unrest last summer, it kind of like added more fuel to their fire because these retailers were thinking, well, the civil unrest equals a loss in revenue and destruction of my property. So I'm going to go for the outcome that, you know, that will assure me that it won't have as much turmoil, so to speak. That was my understanding.
So the big question I had, because I read probably 3/4. And on top of it, time, I really don't like the message they put across. Like, I opened the website and the first one was, why are white people, the first article is, why are white people getting more vaccines than black people? I'm just kind of like, I don't know. I mean, to me, if you count percentage wise, you have a large percentage of people this one, a large percentage or a small percentage here. So even if you did like 30% of the black population, that's still only equal to, you know, 10% or, you know, 20% of the white population kind of thing. So math wise, yeah, that would happen. Kind of. It's just like when I read their articles, I don't find them logical, in my opinion. So when I was reading this, I'm going to come at it at a bad angle and say, yeah, they tampered with public perception of the election. And I didn't like it. I don't feel like it was a fair and equal election.
And you're entitled to that opinion. I mean, so, I think that there's a lot to go in here. I mean, with this article, there's so many different people who are behind getting out information, right? And using their platforms to get out their message. So how can we count on these platforms to give it a fair representation of what's really going on, which I can understand that.
If Facebook is, if Mark Zuckerberg's putting $300 million towards this effort, how can you trust his platform to not be leaning one way? And during this whole event, people like him and Jack Dorsey were in front of Congress saying, we don't do that. We don't censor certain people because of their political beliefs. Well, this article says they were. And also, the article does talk about how they helped sway laws in current states to allow the mail-in voting and other things.
They did.
You know, like Pennsylvania.
And provided, like, poll resources, too.
Yeah. Pennsylvania, they had the big, you know, the big lawsuit that went on there. For one, the lawsuit was thrown out on standing, which was the way it was processed, not on the merits of the case. The merits, so the actual meat of the case was never heard or never talked about. In Pennsylvania, in their state constitution, it states that in order to do mass mail-in ballots in the way they did, you would need a constitutional amendment in their state. Well, that wasn't done. And there was a lot of issues like that. That all state laws that were all changed really quick and all of a sudden and kind of like no one paid attention in the time frames that this article talks about. So like October to December of 2019 is when, in that time frame, is when Pennsylvania enacted mail-in ballots. And there was like items like that, that like, yeah, I know, I guess it's one thing for platforms. Like if Facebook was just like, yeah, we do lean left, okay? So, yeah, we gave Joe Biden a backing. No one would bat an eye, right? It's the lying that everybody has an issue with, that I'd have an issue with.
I can understand that.
Yeah, you want people to be transparent about what they're doing. You want them to be, want companies and people to be transparent about who their horse is, about who they're picking, who their running person is, I suppose. You will.
I mean, even how how you feel on the matter. What happened to Parler, if you look on it from an outside perspective, should scare every single person on the internet. Because within, 24 hours, it was gone.
Well, you know that the CEO
app
did...
App stores.
I remember reading something...
Not talking about the business itself. Like,
oh, okay.
Yeah. To get past that, okay, right? Okay, yeah. Whatever the business did is what the business did. But within 24 hours... Apple, Google removed it both from their Play Stores, and Amazon removed their servers within 24 hours. That should not, your business should not be able to be shut down by three other businesses in 24 hours. That's, I just don't think that's a fair business model at all.
Like, there should be like a review and like some type of avenue that they can go on to have like a fair, I guess, shot.
Yeah. If the FBI did an investigation and said, hey, yeah, this is what was happening on Parler. Here's the results, blah, blah, blah. this action needs to be taken and something happened, I think a lot of people would have accepted it. But just with all the circumstances that have gone around this election from 2019, the end of 2019 till now, there's just too many questions, too many of people. It feels like they're lying to you or using people, manipulating people. I mean, and I don't see it going any better. I don't see unity coming if this is the way we're going to continue to move forward.
That's a fair point. And sidebar, when Ethan starts doing his presidential like banging, this is when he's getting real passionate.
I always try to stay like in part. Like I try my hardest, you know. I don't identify as either party straight up. I do have very conservative beliefs, and I do have some liberal beliefs. I mean, I don't really give a fuck who you fuck, as long as it's not me. You know what I mean? Like, I do me, you do you. We're cool. I really don't care what you do. If you want to go be a polygamist in the hills, I'm not going to say anything. Leave me alone is the best thing to do. And it's funny because today I saw a meme that just, it hit home, right? It was, just wait until the people who just wanted to be left alone get involved. And I think that's the point where people are pushing it.
Speaking of people who want to be left alone, gun owners.
That was a good transition. Segue. It was perfect.
I get what you're saying. But yeah, no, gun owners want to be left the hell alone. So there's a new House Resolution Bill 127. And what's going on with that?
Alan, let's hear it from Alan. Biggest gun owner on the show.
I'm not the biggest gun owner on. I mean, I got these guns.
Hey, they're 50 cals in my book, sexy.
Ah, thank you. Oh, hey, show. I'll fight. I actually have not been able to do proper research on HR 127, but from what I understand, is that in order for you to buy a new gun or ammo, if HR 127 passes. Here, let me do a close-up on me. So you guys can see my beautiful, flowing, curly hair. Wait, that's Ethan. There. So, in order for you to buy gun or ammo with HR 127, you would have to get a psych eval, background, standard, fingerprints, and a mugshot, right? And that also extends to everyone who lives with the person who's buying the gun.
So basically, yes, kind of. Go ahead, Ethan.
The biggest takeaway I get from that is we can all agree criminals are criminals because they don't follow the rules, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if you make a bunch of people who are following the rules criminals, is that their fault?
Yes.
Because something like this would make me a criminal.
So here's a couple of things that are in this resolution. So establish a publicly searchable gun registry containing your private information. It requires you to petition an anti-gun attorney general for a license to possess firearms and ammunition. It would further you to obtain firearms insurance from the federal government at the cost of $800 per year. It bans numerous rifles, AR pistols, shotguns, .50 or greater ammo, or any magazine with a capacity over 10 rounds. And it also slaps gun owners with mandatory minimum prison sentences and fines for violations of the legislation.
So just a quick reference for people who aren't familiar with guns. The way the wording is placed on where it says 50 cal, that is all 50 cal. So that includes 50 cal handguns, which are Desert Eagles. 50 cal or Smith & Wesson 500s and 50 cal BMGs. Which those are the rifle version.
So I feel like, you know, there's a lot to this bill, and personally, I'm not a gun owner, but I do support the right to, you know, to have your arms. But I also feel like being required to purchase an $800 insurance plan from the government is shady and can also be discriminatory towards like poor people. You know, like if you have a gun and you live in a, you know, town or city where, you know, maybe it's necessary that you have to pack to protect yourself. Maybe it's necessary for you to have a firearm, or maybe you go hunting. You have to go hunting. Like that discriminates against them for a fee.
And you lived in a rural area. Did you ever have to deal with a wild hog?
Yes. Oh my God. I dealt with a rabid raccoon one time.
It happened. Mm-hmm. And so that's the biggest thing where everybody's like, we need to restrict guns. I'm the opposite. I say, let's go take everyone to a safety class. Let's get it mandatory and let's go get Alan a gun. Let's go get everybody. If everybody has a gun, then we're all safe.
But Alan made an interesting point. Like the legislators that are trying to push this bill should probably go through the process of what it's like to be a gun owner, like the current as it stands.
Yeah, I said that last night.
And that was a great point because personally, I never feel comfortable. Like, if you ever listen to Washington, D.C. talk about guns, especially like Joe Biden, Nancy Pelosi, you can clearly tell they've never even like owned a gun properly, right? They probably have a shotgun somebody gifted them. You know?
Probably.
Like, they have some Ithaca that Ithaca sent them, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. They've never actually had to get a gun for food purposes, self-defense, or anything. I mean, So they're going to restrict your right to have a gun, but it's going to say nothing about their private security that walks around with them at all times holding a gun.
That's a good point.
Well, did they go through a psych exam and so did their whole family? I'm just kidding.
And so did everyone that lives with them.
Yeah. I mean, so again, we could talk about guns all day.
What's the likelihood of this passing, though? I mean, like, I know that a lot of Democrats barely by the skin of their teeth got elected into their seats, you know, the past couple of elections. If they, and these are in states where they're very pro gun law, like not pro gun laws, but pro guns.
Mm-hmm. A lot of the Northeast is pro gun. They're just hardcore Democrat.
Yeah.
So to me, it's like, if you don't want to lose your constituents, basically, you know, to me, like they would try to hold on to that seat, especially when it comes to a constitutional right, in my opinion. So Raisin says, I wonder if people would be offended if people need mandatory tests to see if they are not nuts.
So Raisin, anything like that, all I can tell you is last year, people in our streets protested for months about how the government is dictatorship, racist, and everything else under the book, and they don't take care of the people. So why are we going to trust them with our why are we going to let them take our last line of self-defense away from us?
Well, I think also too, it's a public registry. Like, I mean, like if people are making targets, like you literally have a list that the government is giving you of people with their information, addresses, etc. Which is, I mean, I guess you could find it now if, you know, you pay for it, but this is a public, it's a federally funded search engine, I guess you could say.
Yeah. And there's certain aspects, you know, like if I gifted you a gun, that's technically not registered to you, right? It could be registered to me. If I bought it off somebody, it could be registered to them. Here in Texas, we do have privacy laws for gun buying and selling. So I just, all of this ruling, and so. You asked about the likelihood of this passing. Well, what gives it some weight is that it's a Texas Democrat pushing it, that wrote it, sponsoring it. So people are like, well, they're from Texas. They know guns. You know, that's the mentality that some people have towards it, right? You'll have that. Other mentality is what we were talking about earlier with like the relief bill. Even if the Republicans say no, there's nothing stopping from the Democrats passing it. At that point, the only thing that would stop anything is the Supreme Court ruling that this is unconstitutional and can't be done. But then again, we can't really rely on the Supreme Court. They haven't stepped up in the last couple of years where they needed to. Mm-hmm. I mean, because, you know, speaking of the election, no matter how you felt on it, I think the Supreme Court should have stepped up and at least made a ruling and said something to where people had to stick by. In turn, they decided to stay quiet because, as Chief John Roberts said, they didn't want to be responsible for rioting either way it went. So it was just easier for them to be quiet. And then, I mean, you also got to take account, like, the McCloskeys, the people from Missouri, that, you know, they were arrested because they were holding their registered firearms in their hand on their property.
Oh, the ones at the private...
You know, technically people were trespassing on their property. Mm-hmm. They armed themselves because they were scared for what would happen. And the police arrested them because it's easier to arrest two people than it is, you know, 200 people. So, well,
there are also reports that they're pointing their guns on people.
Well, the wife did point her gun at people, mm-hmm. but they did prove that the gun was inoperable. So it didn't have a firing pin. And that was, the district attorney actually got in trouble because they go, well, can't you make this work? If it can be made to work, then we should charge her still.
That's bullshit. So,
that's fucked up.
That's bullshit. Yeah,
they're just trying to throw a book at them.
Why would somebody trust those people with their gun, you know, with their private information mm-hmm. about what guns they own?
Exactly.
That's a fair point. Like, especially, sorry, especially in the security field, like, nothing online or anything that is connected to the internet is safe. At some point in time, it will require an update, and if it doesn't get updated, which the government has been known to kind of try to push software past its limits or past its expiration date, so I wouldn't trust the government with that kind of information, unless if some third party took care of it. But even then, what third parties don't want to take care of that information?
How versed are you in the Solar Winds hack that's been going on for the last year and a half?
Dude,
I mean, that right there, why do you want to give them more of your private information? Like, at a certain point, when is the government just going to leave us alone?
Well, not whenever they have Canada spying on Americans and Americans spying on Canadians, because it doesn't violate their own country's laws and just trade information back and forth. Okay.
So the Five Eyes, they all do it. Yeah, that's a crazy conspiracy theory that came true too.
I don't think that it will pass just for those Democrats that are in those states where they narrowly won. I think that there's more things that, I guess, bigger fish to fry currently than gun regulation. Plus, like, to me, it feels like a little bit unconstitutional, especially the federal insurance part. Like, I don't really agree with that.
Yeah.
But moving on, you guys, you know, we were talking about science earlier and different progressions there, but some new developments in the construction business. They have the first 3D house for sale in the U.S. Mm-hmm. in New York.
Why does New York get all the good shit?
So they did a prototype here in Texas. I think it was in Canada, and they had done they had solicited help from this company in Austin where they made like a little house. It was like a little 1,000 square foot 3D printed house, and the cost to build it were halved basically. And the time it took to build it was minimal. I mean, absolute minimal. And it took only two people to operate the machinery to get it done. So the first house hasn't yet to be built for sale, but it is for sale. So the plans are. So basically what this machine does is it lays layers of concrete. Like, I don't know if you guys have ever seen a 3D printer, but it, like, it starts at the bottom and just like lasers it up. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing, but they just do it with concrete. They expect it to last for at least for 50 years. And the materials used aren't as like environmentally impacting. So it's exciting on one hand. On the other hand, you know, when you think about construction workers and things like that, you know, that's a lot of blue collar jobs that could be in jeopardy. So what do you guys think? Are you guys excited for 3D houses or a little hesitant?
Do we get to keep the 3D printer afterwards?
No.
Damn it. So I'm not excited for it anymore.
I've been tracking this for about 3 or 4 years when they started the prototype in Austin, and it was actually pretty interesting to watch. And I don't see now. So the 3D printing would be great for areas that rely mainly on concrete structures, so like New York and other areas. Mm-hmm. But you know, I'm all for like all these alternatives that have come out. So container homes, they're awesome. I have actually drawn up plans looking at doing my own. the foam blocks, have y'all ever seen that? They're pretty much like a Lego set. So you build your house out of foam blocks, and then they fill them full of concrete, and then you put your siding on outside of it, and that's there you cool. go.
Wow.
There's so many options for alternate ways. I just don't think this is going to take off, like, especially if it's how the quality, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. As it stands now.
Yeah, because watching it the way they do, like the rebar is not always the best.
Mm-hmm.
The way they have to do things, like you're really going to still have to build a good structure before you pour it. And I don't see 3D printing doing that. Now, I see 3D printing being amazing for a whole bunch of other shit. Just house mm-hmm. building, I don't think it's going to take off. I mean, but hey, I could be wrong.
I mean,
so to answer cool. your question, Alan, the reason why they did it in New York is because New York has the biggest challenges when it comes to pricing and location and, mm-hmm. you know, like, I guess, withstanding weather. So basically it was like, if we do it in New York, we can do it anywhere.
Oh, and it was kind of funny. Okay. Just Alan said they get all the best stuff, like the most coronavirus cases.
Okay, fair. Maybe not all the best stuff. Maybe some of the bad too.
Yeah, and building an industry like that, I mean, like talking about some of Biden's executive orders, the steel and the other industries that are mainly in that area
mm-hmm.
or the ones mm-hmm. suffering. So maybe it would be beneficial for them to find some new ways to work.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to see like where it takes off. I didn't know about the phone box. That's kind of fun to do. I think, you know, it could be a viable option and an expensive option for, you know, like dealing with the homeless population. Like we had talked about it on episode last year where New York was literally shipping their homeless to other states and setting yeah. up with like rent for a month and then saying peace. You know, maybe something like that would help them with their homeless population.
That's
but then
point.
Again, you know, places like New York, hell, it's like, why does California have the worst homeless population, right? Because you can kind of just be homeless. Like they're the weather's kind of mostly nice. Like New York, you'll freeze in the winter and shit. But like California, it's mainly nice most of the time. And some people just don't want to live in society. So you're never going to solve that problem because you can't solve nature, right? Like some people were just hunter and gatherers and nomads. Like it's our history.
Ooh, mm-hmm. Okay. So quick sidebar. I saw this theory where the reason why women like to shop is because early on, like whenever we were like cavemen and cavewomen, you know, women were the gatherers and the men were the hunters. And so we like finding like things to put in our houses or things to gather. And that's why women like to shop. And I was like, oh, that makes so much sense.
I find these, I gather.
What? Alan, no, you're a hunter. Rar.
No, I find these. I hunted these. I hunted
there
these.
There you go. I hunted these down. There you go. I'll tell you.
It's your prize. It's your prize.
Yes. I took them from nerds.
It's not the best way when Norma's talking about how women are gatherers and you're like, well, I gathered all of these.
I hunted them.
There you go.
Hunted the best deal for it.
Yes, Ryzen. I like meddling with Rubik's Cubes.
Yeah. He showed it a couple of times, so he's really glad that somebody actually commented
yes.
on it.
Yes.
I guess that's one of the things that not a lot of people think about moving forward is that They always try to fit everyone into a box. I guess that's like my biggest problem with modern education, right? Mm-hmm. Like everybody has to go to the public school. Well, I mean, not everyone's the same, you know?
Like, yeah, Karen, jeez.
Let somebody go live in the woods and be a hillbilly. Who cares? You know, as long as they're happy, you don't have to force your way at life on people.
Well, so would you say that about Wanda Maximoff? She's just living her best life.
I don't know. So I was thinking that all the people there were constructs.
Hey, OG Beards.
But, you know, spoiler alert.
Yeah, we're talking about WandaVision, guys.
Yes. Spoiler, they aren't. So I don't want to like spoil too much, but I like where the show's going. I'm glad I stuck around. Me too. And that twist, come on.
I have not been this excited for anything Marvel in the longest time. Like, they're actually lining up with the comics, and it is phenomenal. Like, Wanda and Vision, and the miraculousness of her situation in episode 3. So but it's been fucking great. Like, I'm excited.
One of the guys that break it down that I was watching today, they did give a good explanation, and it does feel like they're following the House of M storyline, mm-hmm. but a little bit in reverse. So instead of her killing the mutants or getting rid of the mutants, then she might be bringing the mutants in to the MCU. And I can't wait. I much rather would have them in.
Norma can tell you, like, I got really fucking nerdy and geeky upstairs, and I was freaking the fuck out once I saw Peter actually walk in the door.
Drop the spoiler.
I'm sorry.
Alan broke the dam. We can let it all out. So I can say that Puzzled has never laughed that hard at a joke I've ever told, but the joke Darcy told, it got her. And I don't know, I was super surprised. I didn't expect it at all. Like, it, you know, they were hinting that her brother, right? But mm-hmm. I expected her brother. I didn't expect X-Men Quicksilver to show up.
I expected
Age of Ultron to show up.
That's a good point. I didn't consider Ultron actually showing up. I mean, Ultron has been brought back multiple times. Throughout the comic series,
Ultron,
but...
Quicksilver.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
But then, even then again, you know, Ultron didn't die.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the whole point of Ultron.
All right, Ryzen.
Have fun, Ryzen. Thanks for hanging out. We appreciate
it. Thanks for hanging out.
So, yeah, I don't know where they're going to go from now, like how hardcore they're going to bring the mutants in, but. Mm-hmm. I'm excited. And they were like, so what I was listening to today, they were talking a little bit how, who are they going to bring in next? Because if they're going to follow the House of M, the next person would be Magneto, mm-hmm. which was technically her, at one point in the comics, her dad.
So, he still is her dad.
Well,
he had triplets, right?
No, there's just the two of them, but they were also mutants at that point. At this point, they're not mutants anymore.
So,
well, now Quicksilver is, but she's not.
Here's an idea. Because this is something that I was thinking about earlier. Is early in the episode, they're talking about, like, she's exuding a lot of power. She's not this powerful to be able to do this. But what if, with her using all of her power, she's somehow... And this is, you know... complete spoiler territory, so I'm sorry if you haven't seen it. I believe that she combined the universes and she made herself into a level 5 mutant. It's the only way that she's got them as power.
That would be possible, but at the same time, the MCU is doing a little bit of a retcon.
Mm-hmm.
So they are trying. So first they were promoting that Captain Marvel was the strongest.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Kevin Feige himself has come out at this point. Scarlet Witch is the strongest in the Marvel Universe. There is mm-hmm. nobody stronger than her at the moment.
It would make sense.
So So I don't think it's more of her merging the universes and becoming a class 5 mutant. I think she's just more or less tapping into the Infinity Stone power more. Because at this point, her powers came from the Infinity Stone. The Infinity Stone was destroyed. So if that Infinity, you know, if you think like cosmic radiation, that's what the Infinity Stone was, right? Mm-hmm. So if the Infinity Stone helped made things and she's all that's left, she would be more or less like a sponge for infinity power, you know, like cosmic radiation in that way. Mm-hmm. So maybe she's just gotten more better at harnessing and was able to tap into a deeper well of the power from the Infinity Stone.
That's a good point. I didn't consider that. Damn it. I was so excited for mutants.
No. I mean, that's totally possible too, because they're bringing in her mutant brother now. So mm-hmm. like that's why I'm saying I'm so curious to see where they're going to go with it, because there's so many valid options that they can do. You know, so the big connection that I was curious to see what y'all thought is the Monica Rambeau. Why do you think she hates Captain Marvel?
Oh my gosh. Yeah. I was thinking about that. Was she like quickly changed her whole demeanor changed at the mention of Captain Marvel?
Well, wasn't her mom Captain Marvel's best friend?
Exactly. Like what?
So that's the fan theory going on right now. Did Captain Marvel and her become more than friends?
Oh.
So the one fan theory that I was listening to was that they think that her and Captain Marvel became more than friends. That's why Captain Marvel is taking a back seat, right, in the MCU currently. Because they got a plan later on down the road where Captain Marvel and her mom were, you know, in love. They were together. The cosmic radiation from Captain Marvel constantly going into space and other things is what led to her cancer, and she blames Carol for giving her cancer.
Oh, that makes a lot of sense.
They were just feeding off of some of what Brie Larson said lately and kind of the things she's alluded to and just kind of the dynamic in the movie that they think in Captain Marvel 2, they're going to put it out there that Carol Danvers is in a gay relationship with her mom. So
that makes sense why she had cancer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, like mm-hmm. their whole theory kind of made sense. That's why I'm like, hey, that makes sense. But
that explains why 5 years in she was always off world.
Yeah.
Interesting. Things that make you say,
yeah, so that's why there's so much going around in the Marvel universe that I kind of died out, and I will never be as big a fan as I was, you know, for the Infinity War arc. Like, that was the MCU to me, but I'm willing to give, you know, where WandaVision and where some of the newer stuff is heading, like, I'm at least going to, you know, watch it. But yeah, the first two episodes of WandaVision, I was like, well, this is cool, but it seems kind of corny. And then the twist started, and I'm like, okay, this is getting better, this is getting better. Okay, well, maybe they're not going to do all the, like, political messaging and kind of the belief shoved down your throat that you kind of felt coming. Mm-hmm. That now they're getting back to more of the stories, and I just want to read this. I just want to watch the stories, man. Come on.
It makes me want to go back and renew my Marvel Unlimited account. Like, this is...
I know Puzzle looks... Sorry.
Yeah, she asked me to take her to a comic book store yesterday. I was like, where did this come from? What?
So, what we're seeing right now in WandaVision is something that we've already seen in the comic strips and comic series for Wanda. One of the things that had happened in one of the earlier... comics, I don't remember the name, but Wanda had the same kind of issue, and she had a mental breakdown from Vision after they had been divorced. So in the comic series, they got married, She couldn't have kids, so she made them using her own powers. And then Vision, you know, took the role as father, and then a year later, he wants a divorce, and Wanda, with the help of Doctor Strange, actually erases memory in her memory, and it turns out that her kids are actually hurt. I think it was mutant, I believe. I remember the villain. Yeah, well, in
that storyline, she was a mutant.
Yeah, yeah. But they were Mephisto's kids. Yeah, she had made a deal with Mephisto so that she can become pregnant, kind of the same way that Peter Parker had made a deal with Mephisto to bring back Aunt May, but he would have to sacrifice Mary Jane for it.
So dark.
So, speaking of Spider-Man and Mary Jane, though, what gave some credit to the Captain Marvel theory is that is a storyline that Spider-Man has done in the comics at one point, that because of him and Mary Jane, when they got married and lived a longer life together, his radiation bled into her and gave her cancer and killed her.
Mm-hmm.
So they've done that kind of, like, they've already, you know, used that story a little bit. And Marvel has a knack for, they like the sure thing, you know, if they've already tried it.
Mm-hmm. So, tried and true.
Yeah. Tried and true. But
the big thing is, do you think Magneto is going to show up in the show?
Oh, I hope so. I really fucking hope so.
Which one do you think is going to show up?
Oh, I really hope that it's Sir Ian McKellen. But
really? I kind of hope so, but Michael Fassbender.
Oh.
Like, it would make more sense he would show up because of... it's Evan Peters, right? Is the guy that plays Quicksilver. Yeah. Because Evan Peters' Quicksilver showed up, it would make more sense that Michael would show up, but at the same time, you know, there's only one real Magneto, and we can all agree.
Yeah. But you are right. Like, essentially, the entire X-Men storyline, like the movies, they've retconned so much of it where really the only two you really need to watch are X-Men, X-Men 2, and then Days of Future Past. And then the ones, the first class, and that's it. Like, X-Men 3 was completely retconned. Everything after that was completely retconned, too.
Yeah, because the Wolverine and Logan are in their own time zone, or their own time frame.
Mm-hmm.
They're not a part of the main storyline anymore.
I wonder, once they bring up X-Men, who they're going to cast as Logan.
That's another thing I was curious, because
I'm totally fine with not ever seeing another Logan. Like, I'm good.
Yeah, I'm good with that too, but at the same time, I think they're gonna do it in a right way. Like, it feels like they're gonna go in the right direction. And so if they introduce somebody like that, I think it will come off better. It'll be well received.
Okay.
So it kind of would have to be Hugh Jackman. And the reason why I'm saying that is because, do you remember the ending scene of I think it was one of the Thor movies. It had him, what's his name? The S.H.I.E.L.D. agent. He's like, he died. What was his name?
Oh. Yeah.
He approached Wolverine at the bar to recruit him for the Avengers, and Logan told him to Wolverine told him to fuck off.
Oh, well, actually the scene you're talking about is that's when they tried to recruit him to the X-Men in the
X-Men? First class. Yeah. It was X-Men.
Because I only remember that specific one because that is the one F-bomb allowed in a PG-13 movie, and they gave it to Wolverine.
Yeah, he deserves it.
Because that leads into Days of Futures Past.
Mm-hmm.
I have to be honest, I have not seen a lot of X-Men. I think I watched like the first three movies and didn't watch anything else.
NJ, it gets better.
The one that I was upset was Dark Phoenix.
Oh, yeah, we're not watching Dark Trash.
Dark Phoenix is supposed to be a cosmic being, but they couldn't do cosmic beings because Marvel had the rights currently at that time. Or no, Sony had the rights because they had Fantastic Four. And then they had Silver rights Surfer. To certain cosmic beings, and then Marvel had the other rights to the cosmic beings. So it kind of like threw that kind of down the drain. That was useless. But if they do anything, I want Marvel to do a full Dark Phoenix, like true story.
Yeah, like dedicate, not dedicated, but a true adaptation from the comic series. Like,
yeah, because Jean Grey is supposed to be the only level 5 mutant to ever be born.
Another, oh, I thought there was two.
No, she, well, okay. Legion's pretty close. Yeah. I don't know if Legion, what I want to say he's probably a level 5.
Let's find out.
But the comic book Legion versus TV Legion is totally two different guys. Like, he can alter reality himself as a mutant.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Apocalypse was a level 5 mutant.
Oh, yeah, he's the original, right?
Yeah, he's the original.
So what do you think we're going to see before the season ends? So I think it ends, what, March 5th is what Jay was saying in our Marvel chat?
I'm thinking we're going to see Magneto come in, and they're going to leave it on a cliffhanger of Magneto coming into the show, and then they're going to have the break. Spider-Man 3 is going to happen where she's in that, and then the show will pick up after Spider-Man 3.
I don't think it's going to be Magneto. I think it's going to be another prolific, not prolific, another intelligent scientist. Because there was a hint about a scientist in the episode, and I think I know which one.
Reed Richards is the only guy that I can think of to bring in.
Exactly.
Like, who, I mean, they got the rights to the Fantastic Four also. So,
all their properties are back.
Well, yeah, but then again, on the same time, the Avengers more or less took over where the Fantastic Four kind of did their thing. Like, the big tower in New York is supposed to have a giant 4 on it, not an A, you know?
Maybe he buys it and turns it into an A.
Yeah, no, that's a great idea, too. That could happen.
I mean, Pepper Potts isn't going to run all of Stark Tower. She'll want to bring it down, and she already has over at Avengers Base.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, I could talk about this all night.
Well, I think we're gonna have to come back and revisit this next week and see what next episode holds for us. We only have a couple of episodes left. Mm-hmm. So what do you guys think? Should we wrap it up and raid somebody?
Good. Yeah. I just want to say right after WandaVision, Falcon Winter Soldier comes out. So
finally,
it's another thing to look forward to.
Yeah.
That's another reason to keep your Disney Plus subscription right now.
Damn it.
Right now, yeah. So, let's see. Who y'all feel like raiding?
Norkalus started going live at night. He's live right now, as a matter of fact.
I'm looking at somebody who doesn't really have that many views.
Okay. We can do this.
Devils is streaming. Hey Uboob, he always hangs out in Puzzled Stream. He's streaming.
Oh, that's cool.
JW,
I'm all for the randos.
Ooh, Maddie's streaming right now.
Let's bring in some new viewers to some people who maybe don't come in as much. That's that guy. His name. And then perfect. There's this guy. He's playing Last of Us and he has two viewers.
Sir Nanik. Oh, darn. That's.
My hands have been so dry. I hate this weather.
It's the worst.
So, this weekend, when we went up to Houston, we went to the farmer's market and I got a apple and honey bar of soap.
Sir Nick already went offline.
Oh.
My hands are so soft.
Sounds nice. I saw this ad earlier, I think when I was getting into Vader stream for Valheim. Have you guys seen an ad for that yet? It looks pretty fun.
No, I gave in. I did download a Top War, the little mobile game. That was pretty fun so far.
All right, we're gonna go.
It's nothing like the commercials, though.
Boo.
All right, guys, thanks for coming tonight. I know that we have Circle of Jerks this Wednesday with Prez of the Castle. If you guys are not following Prez, please give him a follow. I can spell castle correctly. He's an awesome streamer. He's been opening up Pokemon cards recently. And right now, I think he's doing a Nuzlocke challenge with Extreme, right? OG Beers just got back. Also, OG Beers, to answer an earlier question, I don't solve these for time. I just like solving them.
But now he's totally going to time so he can tell you what his time is.
My coworker.
He's going to do the four square one.
This one?
I've never solved a Rubik's Cube in my life. I'm so sad.
I'm not gonna lie, at first this one was pretty difficult, but it is easier to use now. Like, now that I figured it out.
I'm gonna get you one of those like 20 ones.
Bet. I'll totally solve it. Bring it to me unsolved. But thanks for stopping, guys.
Here, hi everybody.
Our shout outs to our producer of the week. What's up?
This is an official Millennials production.